Good morning, everybody. Welcome to today's Healing Minute from the virtual Harry Edwards Healing Sanctuary. Healing blessings wherever you are, whether you're watching live or on catch-up. Please remember our motto, wherever you are, we are here for you. I'm John, speaking to you today from Hillingdon, West London, on Saturday the 12th of June. I'm pleased to see it's working today and the IT gremlins have not sunk me this time. If you hear a loud noise, please don't worry. It's just aircraft landing at Northolt Airport, which is very close. In the last week, because of the G7 summit in Cornwall, we've had all sorts of planes coming in here. In fact, two of the largest planes ever to land at Northolt arrived this week. For the aircraft aficionados, they were the Globemasters C-17s. The picture you're looking at is a rose in my garden, or our garden, I should say. Sue loves roses. And this rose is named Mum in a Million. And it reminds me of the heart chakra. And curiously enough, the music I'm playing is from Journey to the Temple by Llewellyn. And the track I started off with was Heart Chakra. And this album is one of my favourites, which I love healing to when I'm at the sanctuary, which feels a long time ago. Thank you for joining us for today's Healing Minute. This session includes an opportunity, as I hope you realise, for each of us to send healing to the people and animals we know are in need, especially the souls close to us. And we think of our dear Tana at this time, who lost her mum the other day to the spiritual realm, and all the troubles across the world at this time. After we've done the Healing Minute, I'm just going to chat today about synchronicity and how, if we are aware, it touches all of us in our daily lives. And for those sadly who are not aware, it comes and goes and they have no realization. The finishing music sums up to me the picture of the rose in a way and our relationship with it. And it's sung by a very delightful young lady who is unfortunately no longer with us and led a very troubled life, but grew up very close to myself and Sue, and indeed George and Doreen. I'll tell you more about that later, but I'm going to turn the music off now as we prepare for the Healing Minute. So let us relax in preparation. Please close your eyes if it's safe to do so, and in your mind take yourself off to your own personal sanctuary, somewhere that you feel perfectly safe, totally at ease and completely peaceful. Take a deep breath and inhale the healing energy and allow it to flow through your body from the top of your head to the tips of your toes. As you breathe out, Let go of all your personal stresses and any dis-ease in your daily life. Next, we seek to attune with spirit. And we use the words that Harry gave us for this purpose. We give thanks that we are gathered here today. We ask that this place be filled with love, light, friendship, and healing energies. Surround us in protection as we open our hearts and expand our consciousness to allow the flow of love and healing to come through us. As our crown chakra opens, we visualize a column of pure white light filling our body. Then feel the balance and harmony within our body as the earth energy rises up through the soles of our feet and our base chakra. We feel our connection to the universal source of pure, unconditional love, balanced by the nurturing, protective love of Mother Earth. Let's read the sanctuary prayer next. Heavenly Father, I surrender myself to the good influencing of your healing ministers in spirit, that through your divine healing power, the disharmonies within me might be overcome and the stresses of mind and body be eased and lessened day by day. Help me to adopt a more positive approach and a helpful way of thought. Bring me into closer harmony with those around me and with the divine healing purpose. And for those who are sick or in the darkness of despair, who do not know of the help that can reach them from spirit, I pray that awareness will come to them soon, that they too might experience the upliftment of spirit that can lead us all through harmony towards true health. May God bless you. Amen. And now the great invocation. From the point of light within the mind of God, let light stream forth into human minds. Let light descend on earth. From the point of love within the heart of God, let love stream forth into human hearts. May the coming one return to earth. From the centre where the will of God is known, let purpose guide all little human wills towards the purpose which the masters know and serve. From the centre which we call the human race, let the plan of love and light work out, and may it seal the door where evil dwells. Let light and love and power restore the plan on earth. We ask now that all the people whose names we hold in the distant healing folder may receive healing for their highest good. We also request healing for their family, friends, and the people who have requested distant healing. May they be placed in the healing light and receive that which they are allowed to receive for their highest good. Let us take a minute of silence to send out that healing love. Thank you. Our thanks and blessings for your help here today and to our friends in spirit. I've added to this page a donation button because during this time of lockdown, although we give healing freely, well, when we say freely, we hope for a donation because we are a charity and our costs are quite large. But if you feel inclined and you feel that you've benefited from today's session and can afford it, please send us a few pounds. But now I'm going to move on to my little thing today to say about synchronicity. For us who are spiritualists, and there are many, if not all, amongst us, we recognise that spirits give us messages. They send us indications, guidance, and sometimes a reprimand in ways that we don't always recognise. To the uninitiated, these are just events which occur, and they call them coincidence. I don't personally don't believe in coincidence. I believe that spirit send us messages. And sometimes we end up meeting people, saying things, doing things, and we've no idea why. And we probably will never find out until we reach the other side. But I'm going to tell you a few little stories of my own and my wife Sue's personal journey about how spirit have manoeuvred us into situations to work for them. So how were we brought to Burrows Lee? And I use the word brought deliberately because I don't believe people end up coming to Burrows Lee. I believe they have been brought for reasons known only to their spirit guides. So it's a long story, but I'm not going to tell you all the story, just a little bit. It involves a friend of ours by the name of Corrie, who was a great friend and a real soul sister to my wife Sue. And she gave us a press cutting one day. It had been published 12 days previous and was a double page spread in the Daily Star about Ray and Joan Branch and their work at the sanctuary. And for once, being the press, it was actually written fairly. But we were given that because our baby daughter, Naomi, had just been born and she's had a large hole in the heart. And we needed help desperately. So one Wednesday, it was December 1984, it was wet, it was cold, but we drove, this is before the M25 of course, drove to Shear and asked in the post office, could they direct us to Burrows Lee? And the person behind the counter duly told us where it was. And we arrived and we rang the doorbell. Thus begun a 35-year journey that we have had and continue to this day to be involved in the Harry Edwards Healing Sanctuary. We never met Harry, unfortunately, which is a great sadness, but there you go. Corrie was meant to give us that piece of newspaper and it was meant to be published at that time, and that's how spirit communicated. I believe it was synchronicity, and that is how we were brought to the sanctuary. But let me tell you a story about my dad. He wasn't a spiritualist, and I wasn't born into spiritualism, unlike Alan and George, who were. But my dad told us a story. He's no longer with us, unfortunately, that in October 1952, he was working in Harrow, and we were living in Harrow Weald. And the journey between the two, because he never drove, was undertaken by bus. And one evening he was riding home on the top deck of a bus, and he looked out of the window making that journey, as we all often do when we're on buses, and he saw the most horrendous scene of total carnage and devastation, and then looked back and all was as normal. But he was passing Harrow and Wealdstone station, which on the following morning at 8:17, on the 8th of October 1952, 112 people lost their lives and 340 were injured when three trains, including two express trains, collided. I don't know why he saw that, I don't think he knew why he saw it, but it was a premonition. Let me tell you one last story, because I don't want to bore you with these. Sue and I were sitting in our conservatory, which we love, one day, about 1999. And Sue said to me, "I feel the urge to make contact with my childhood friend, Pat. She needs me. She is in need and I need to give her something." We hadn't seen Pat for quite some time because we were married in 1976 and had seen her in that year. And not since, because she'd moved to Maidstone. And we began to discuss how we might track down Pat. And we discussed her husband, whose name was Paul, and the fact it was strange that he happened to work in the same industry that I did, which was financial services. Sue told me his surname, and I said, that's an unusual name. And then I went cold, because a fortnight previously, I had been standing outside a hotel in the Midlands on one of these conferences that people go on. And a gentleman by the name of Paul had been the keynote speaker. And he was talking about leadership skills and human motivation. And I realised that was Pat's husband. So I rushed upstairs and brought down a booklet we had been given at the conference, which had his photo. And I showed it to Sue, and she said, "My goodness, that is Paul, Pat's husband." We knew the company he worked for, and we made in telephone inquiries, and we tracked Paul down. And he said that Pat did need help. She was in the grip of alcohol, badly, and had either was shortly or had been diagnosed with cancer. And so, for those last few months, Sue and Pat were reunited. We attended the funeral when she finally passed to spirit and consoled the family. I think life tends to work the fact that we need to give comfort to those who have had a bereavement. But that's just three little stories. And I believe that spirit uses us all in ways that we find out. Anyway, time for parish notices. Because I was due to give this on Friday, I don't know who's doing the Healing Minute tomorrow. It's probably Doreen, being a Sunday. But also, Alan will be doing Healing for You on Zoom at 10:30 a.m. And on Wednesday the 16th at Cygnus on Facebook and Zoom, we have Karen, who is an intuitive therapist and will be talking about maintaining optimal energy and tools for vibrant health and abundance. As always, these talks are recorded and will be available to watch online via the usual sources. We have on Monday the 21st of June our first real live event at the sanctuary for the summer solstice. I regret, because we have presenters coming from some distance, there is a charge, and it will be on from 10:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. So on that note, I'm going to say farewell. Thank you for spending your valuable time with us. I'm going to play some music shortly. The sanctuary is open for COVID secure healing. And of course, if you need to chat to us or require distant healing, please contact us in the usual way. You can't just turn up at the sanctuary to visit yet, until Boris finally announces Freedom Day, and then things will be a little easier. But the music I'm going to play is, as I said earlier, by a delightful young lady who, as a teenager, I admired incredibly. She was blonde and she had the most phenomenal voice. And she worked on a Saturday, I'm told, in her youth at the Co-op in West Ealing, which is not a million miles from here. So I'm going to put you back to the rose picture and play Dusty Springfield's Windmills of Your Mind.
Round like a circle in a spiral, like a wheel within a wheel, never ending or beginning, a never spinning wheel, like a snowball in a mountain, or a carnival, like a carousel that's turning, running rings around the moon, like a clock whose hands are sweeping as the minutes. And the world is like an apple whirling silently in space, like the circle that you find in the windmills of your mind. Like a tunnel that you follow to a tunnel of its own, down a hollow to a cavern where the sun has never shone, like a door that keeps revolving in a half-forgotten dream, or the ripples from a pebble someone tosses in a stream. Like a clock whose hands are sweeping past the minutes of its face. And the world is like an apple whirling silently in space. Like the circles that you find in the windmills of your mind. Keys that jingle in your pocket, words that jangle in your head. Why did summer go so quickly? Was it something that you said? Lovers walk along the shore and leave their footprints in the sand. Is the sound of distant drumming just the fingers of pictures hanging in the hallway and the fragment of a song? Half remembered names and faces, but to whom do they belong? When you knew that it was over, you were suddenly aware that the autumn leaves were turning to the color of
thank you very much for spending your time to help others. Hope you have a pleasant weekend, and I'll be back Friday week.